Greetings everyone, I am Aliza Jaffrey and I welcome you to another edition of the CIST Faculty Conversation Series. Today I am privileged to be joined by someone without whose unflinching support and scholarly flair all that we do through the platforms of CISPR and the UOL would not have been possible, Mr. Avash Rauf. Mr. Avash Rauf has a knack of steering many a ship and that too simultaneously. He is the Chairman Board of Governors, University of Lahore, Honorary Council of Uganda in Pakistan, and Editor-in-Chief of Jahan Publications in Pakistan Politico. As someone who is dealing with the COVID-19 induced crises in the fields of education and health, he is ideally poised to talk about the implications of the pandemic on education, health, and the dynamics of global politics. So thank you very much for joining us and giving time out of your busy schedule. It is only pertinent that I start off this conversation by talking a bit about your life. We see that you have a knack of simultaneity, from teaching philosophy and finance to running one of the largest private sector universities in Pakistan and a hospital, to conducting health diplomacy in Africa, especially in Uganda. You have seen it all and done it all. I want to ask as to what and who inspired you towards doing all these things simultaneously at a very young age.
Thank you very much, Ali. It's an honor to be part of this session. If I go back and try to put together how all of this happened, then probably the biggest inspiration I've had in my life, somebody who has been inspiring me throughout, is my own father, who was the pioneer and the architect behind the largest university, private sector university in the country, University of Lahore, which was conceived some 20 years ago. Initially, obviously, if I go back, my subject area has always been finance, and history and philosophy has been the greatest interest. Otherwise, I started off as a teacher, as a faculty member. I really enjoyed first few years of teaching to undergraduate classes, but later, as I progressed in life, Providence probably had this plan in mind that I moved away from teaching and went into high level management and administration. And then about 10 years ago I took over as the head of this organization, and since then I believe that I have been able to give my maximum to the growth of University of Lahore and all other associated enterprises that we have with it, which includes a 450 bedded hospital, which is now a dedicated corona center. We have a very large number of COVID-19 patients admitted. We have been able to treat many as well, while many more end up showing at the doors every day. I know it's a crisis which is growing in Pakistan, but I think we have been at the forefront. So life has slowly, gradually taken me across. But one very interesting thing that happened to me about 10 years ago was when I first went to Africa. I was asked by Islamic Development Bank to look at a proposal of setting up a medical school in Uganda for Muslim community. It was a multi-country initiative. We had Saudis and Malaysians and us from Pakistan in that project. I was asked to steer it. We were able to build the medical school and launch it within a period of 4 years. Just last year we had our first graduates from that medical school. Uganda is predominantly a Christian country. Muslims are a very decent minority, decent sized minority, but there aren't enough doctors in Uganda. But now every year we will be producing about 100 Muslim boys and girls doctors in that country. We also have Christian students there, so it's a very good mix. So that was what took me to Africa. I was then, because of this project, I was awarded by the president, and then I was made the Honorary Council of Uganda to Pakistan. So this is how things have been shaping up, very much on their own. It was not preconceived, obviously it was not planned, but I have been going with the flow, I would say.
So as one of the users of the online education system, I would like to ask a question on the education and the pandemic. So COVID-19 has, you know, hit the mainstream forms of education very badly, and that has forced universities, colleges and schools to enter the online world of pedagogy. University of Lahore has been one of the few universities that has successfully completed a semester, and now we are in our finals week. How were you able to come up with a system that was not only teacher friendly but also student friendly, and how were you able to transfer and transition from the mainstream to the online system, and what does that system affect, and how does it affect the future of education in Pakistan and elsewhere?
I mean, it's a good question. It's a very relevant question for us. When you're into education in any part of the world today, nearly all the institutions in the world have closed down because they were becoming the breeding ground for COVID-19. So the first point was that we had not seen anything like this for the last 100 years. So there was basically no experience with anyone as to how to deal with this problem. So the day it started and universities were closed down, we obviously we had only two options. One was to keep the institutions closed, like it has happened with many public sector universities in Pakistan. The other one was obvious, to carry on providing education through online systems. Now, I will go back into the background of how it all evolved in our institution. We, for the last two and a half years, were actually working on putting together a very robust online education system. We were doing it not because we knew obviously what was coming. We were doing it because we thought that this is how we can take our reach across all parts of Pakistan, and obviously we can take it internationally to other parts as well, and we can engage more and more students from all over the world into teaching and learning on University of Lahore platforms. So we were doing two things. We were working very aggressively on a learning management system. We were training our existing students on it. Many departments had already shifted on a learning management system, which was not online as such, but it was only as a supplementary system providing support to existing teaching and learning. The other thing we were doing was where we were already building the largest, probably one of the largest private clouds in the country, a data center in the private sector to support, in terms of storage and processing, an online system that would provide teaching and learning to students in large numbers. I'll give you an example how I define large numbers. Just last week, at one point in time, we had 35,000 students studying at one time across many cities and 16 countries in different faculties of the University of Lahore. They were all off campus, all faculty were off campus, but our systems were able to not only provide complete support, sustain that level of numbers as well. So this, while COVID came out of nowhere, but our readiness was there and was building up for the last many years. It looks like as if it all connected at once. We have used many different solutions. For example, we are using Zoom as well for video conferencing. We are using Moodle as well. For examination, we are using a different system. We are right now testing our platform for examination. We can test up to 10 to 12,000 students at a time, where each and every student is getting a different question at a different time from a data bank. So this way, when I look at our platform today, it surprises me, because I could have never imagined that we could have offered such a robust system to our students that could have handled everyone from every part of the world. We have many international students, 16 nationalities. Most of the students have gone back to their countries. starting from Afghanistan to Nepal to Jordan to many African countries, students are right now getting connected every day from those countries. They have been examined, they have been delivered lectures, everything is functioning properly. We have evolved as well in the last 2 months. We did find difficulties offering examinations initially, but then we purchased some more solutions, deployed them, they have been a success. So if God forbid COVID carries on, I see next semester, especially summer and fall, we will have even better solution for our students. Is it an opportunity? Absolutely. How will it serve us, our purpose in the future? We have to see. Because with this ability, this system support, I think institutions, including University of Lahore and many other, can go international. Last year, a North American university, very renowned university, gave a plan, 10-year plan, where they wanted to have close to 1 million students enrolling from all over the world. And they were obviously planning it on the basis of online systems. But I'm sure now they'll be ready for it within a year, because everything because of COVID-19 has now changed. And we are looking at a new world. And I think in Pakistan, along with some other institutions, we at University of Lahore are most ready for that future.
So I would just like to have a quick follow-up question to this. I heard that the Prime Minister was appreciative of the efforts of the University of Lahore's online education system. So are you in talks with the government of, you know, offering this system and developing it to a larger scale across Pakistan and helping the government out in this initiative?
I think the first and foremost was to create a very reliable system for our students, for our numbers, which I think we have. After the end-term exams are over and examination module is completely tested and tried, we can go out to the government institutions and offer our solutions to them. Our data center has a capacity to provide support to more than 500,000 students for teaching and learning, and a very large number of students for examination as well. So it will be very important for us to go out and provide what we have created to each and every institution out in the country, let it be public sector or private sector. Already many private sector institutions are assisting each other in terms of solutions, sharing their experiences, even sharing the solutions available. So the same kind of cooperation should be made available to the public institutions. I believe that. I have already discussed it with many concerned government officials, and they are looking forward to it. Initially, everyone had thought that this COVID would end within 2 to 3 months. Now it looks that it's going to extend till probably till the end of the year. So the universities and colleges and schools will probably remain closed. So these online systems will become even more important and relevant in the next few months. And since we have tried out our solution, I think it's very much possible that the government also takes support from us, and we'll be more than happy doing that.
Okay, talking of COVID, you have been in the thick of things in dealing with this COVID-19 as the head of the UL Teaching Hospital. Tell us as to how have you dealt with the pandemic? How has the University of Lahore's Teaching Hospital built its capacity? And how do you assess the future implications of COVID-19 on the healthcare infrastructure of Pakistan, both in this period and once the pandemic is over?
I think we can divide this into three very important issues. Number one, will this pandemic be over within the year, or we see it going extending into the next year? So first of all, COVID-19 is not going anywhere. Every expert believes that now it's going to stay forever. It's just that we will achieve herd immunity over some time, over many months, and then it will stay around like avian flu and other flows. So this stays within the societies forever. We build our immunity and we build our systems to deal with it. If you remember, in 2011 or 12 we had dengue as a problem. Initially, first few months, there were many casualties. But then our systems, our doctors, our institutions were able to build enough understanding and capacity to deal with it. Now, every year, even if we have it, we can deal it better. So the same will probably happen with COVID-19. What we did at University of Lahore was, first, in our teaching hospital, we started off with 50-bedded COVID center, treatment center. We also started a PCR lab for COVID testing, because they go hand in hand, in my opinion. As this pandemic started building up in Pakistan, initially, first few weeks, there were not enough patients for treatment and testing, and it looked that what we have done is enough as a center. Enough beds are there in the ICUs and otherwise in private rooms and wards, and what we have done is a good contribution to University of Lahore faculty and students, and also to the larger communities. But in the last 2 weeks, the way this virus has spread in the society, in the city of Lahore, nearly every other household, I think it will be very difficult for us or any other private and government institution to claim that they are able to cope up with it. Every day we end up refusing many patients because our beds are full. Our ICU is full for the last two and a half, 3 weeks. One patient who is treated, recovers, once leaves ICU bed, there are 5 patients in waiting. So it's a very critical situation. Sometimes it gets very depressing as well. On the other hand, the testing lab, every day numbers are rising. We are now testing close to 100, 150, 200 people every day. We provide discount in terms of testing and treatment to our faculty and students. I think that is a contribution towards the University of Lahore family. Today we have also completed the development of our own indigenously developed PCR kit, testing kit, that will go into trials from Tuesday onwards, and then we intend getting approval from DRAP and probably start marketing this kit within 15-20 days. So I think we are trying to contribute in many different ways towards this pandemic, towards fighting out this pandemic. And we have been successful in many areas, and I hope even going into the future we can contribute even more.
So as someone who is also dealing with the health crisis, and also as someone who is an employer of many a people, you are ideally positioned to talk about the lives versus livelihood debate. So how do you look at that debate, especially in developing countries, including Pakistan? And what do you make of governments, especially the federal government's refusal or reluctance to impose a countrywide and a blanket lockdown across Pakistan?
I think there are many countries in the world who have gone into an absolute lockdown, and they have been able to manage COVID for some time. While COVID will stay around, and there will be second, third waves of COVID-19 hitting many countries who have been able to deal with the first wave in a very good manner. Pakistan and countries like Pakistan, India, the problem with them is that they, in case they go into an absolute lockdown, the poor people, the number of poor people who have to earn a livelihood on daily basis, they can probably not survive, since there is, the governments are not able to give them their wages through support. When businesses shut down, they're not able to earn anything. I don't think countries like Pakistan can go into this absolute lockdown. They obviously have to plan something like a smart lockdown. where people can carry on learning, earning their livelihoods. The vulnerable people should obviously go indoors and try to protect them. As we have seen in our hospital and across the world, COVID-19 is most dangerous for certain people who are in late ages, who have underlying health conditions, who have their immunities suppressed. So there are certain type of people who need to be protected under all circumstances. They are most vulnerable to COVID-19. So I think let's try to put them indoors and protect them most, and still carry on with daily, day-to-day businesses while remaining very vigilant. Certain areas will have higher number of COVID patients. Those areas maybe would need to go into more of a tougher lockdown. Some areas with low number of patients or suspects probably would have to carry on with their routines. So I am for what the government is saying. I believe that we cannot sustain an absolute lockdown, because maybe up to 70% people, they do not have enough savings with them to survive more than 10-15 days in this country without any earnings. If that is the reality on the ground, how can you shut down everything? Maybe COVID will kill X number of people, but hunger would kill 3 times that. So our governments have to go very smartly. They have to change strategies on day-to-day basis. But absolute lockdown is not a solution, is not an option for countries like Pakistan. So I think it has to be a smart lockdown. Let's see how government comes up with it and whether people actually follow it or not.
With this, we come towards the last question of our conversation. And I would like to bring everything that we have discussed into the frame and talk about the global political landscape. You have had a keen eye on international affairs, and as you said, you like history and other disciplines, and you do realize the importance of soft power when it comes to the shifting dynamics of Sino-US relations. How do you look at the future of this great power rivalry? Will China rule the roost? Will the US bounce back with a vengeance? What will this relationship be like? And what role do you see for health diplomacy in this overall rivalry? Because you have seen China play a great role in countries that have been affected by the pandemic, and especially in Africa. You know Africa quite well. Chinese have ingressed in Africa even before the pandemic. So how do you look at this situation and the overall dynamics of the rivalry going forward?
Yes. I think I'm sure every other expert, every other individual or academician or researcher who works on Sino-US relations must be wondering how this pandemic would ultimately affect the struggle of power between these two countries. And I'm sure that people have a better understanding of this than me, but I believe that US still obviously remains sole superpower in the world. Pandemic will affect US in many ways. We've had recent rioting in the country as well, and that has also seemingly worsened the situation for US. While China has in the last 2 months brought back its economy on the track, they were affected by COVID-19 obviously before any other country, but through a very strong regimen, they've been able to bring back their economy on track as well. All their factories are working, all their economic zones are operational, they are producing. There is a problem on the demand side, because the highest demand was from the Western countries. Since those economies have not come back, so there isn't enough demand, but the fact that Chinese are now poised to produce, so the day you see economies, the consumer-based economies coming back on track, Chinese production and manufacturing units will be producing probably full throttle. Will US give away this position of being the sole superpower to China very soon? In my opinion, no, I don't think so. America will come back once they are done with this first or second wave. You will see that American economy will spring back with a vengeance, yes. Americans must already be planning how to take back that initiative which they seemingly have lost to China in economic terms, probably not in geopolitical terms. Chinese have been creating this ingress across the world, third world countries, for last many years. They have been helping African countries, they've been helping many countries, especially through BRI and all. Now, in the last 2 months, through health diplomacy, maybe they've even done more. But does it always create for them goodwill? Maybe not. I've seen in African countries where Chinese have gone in to support each and every aspect of development, but still people are not very friendly towards Chinese companies and people. So that is already there. That formula has already been there with the Chinese for many years now. In my opinion, people do blame sometimes even Chinese for this pandemic as well. Many countries you find they think that it's because of the Chinese, some think it's because of the Americans or whatever struggle is going on, maybe it's some bioweapon or something, I don't know. So American economy has the capacity and the society to spring back. To me, America remains a sole superpower for many, many decades to come. They are not giving up this position very soon. Chinese have got an advantage. Let's see how long they can carry on with it. But there is a reality that I feel that even if China is getting initiatives and is getting opportunities to take that position, there is always reluctance in the leadership. Chinese, especially the current leadership in China, maybe few generations later their mindset will change. You can call, people call them the reluctant superpower, you know, the reluctant imperialist. So Chinese, even if they get that opportunity, they do not want to exploit it. They want to give this image that they are there, yes, they are powerful and they are strong and they are there to help the world. They are not going to behave like an imperial power. Maybe it's because of their past and the way they were treated by many other imperial powers. So it will take them some years to become more aggressive and robust to exploit their economic and military might. As of today, I don't see that. The Chinese are very keen in carrying on with their economic build-up. They will obviously build their military along with it because that is needed to sustain an economic development program. But that is not their main foray. They are not going to exploit it as their principal point of strength. It will always remain the economic. How this will fare in the future is to see. If America comes back with more aggression, how will China deal with it? When I look at what is happening between India and China, I see that Chinese have ingressed into the Indian side only, to me, not because they want to wage a war, they want to settle a lot of their issues with India within the next few months so that America is not able to exploit these disputes. So these few months will be an opportunity for China to build themselves up for whatever America would want to do once it gets out of these crises.
Sir, thank you very much for this resounding conversation. We must wish you good luck for all that you are doing in the fields of education and health, especially in these times of crises. I think it's important for us to make the world understand that public policy is not just about copy pasting, it's about applying solutions based upon local customs, traditions and the local environment, instead of just you know painting everything with a broad brush. So I thank you once again, and thank you for all the support that you have been extending to us. So viewers, that was it from us today. I would like to say that this video would be uploaded on our CISPR YouTube channel later today, and I must tell that a lot of other conversations are in the pipeline. So stay tuned to CISPR for all our events, conversations, webinars. We had a webinar yesterday with Andrew Small on part-channel relations. The video is already up on the channel. We have already had conversations on Kashmir, on the security trilemma in the region. We have had faculty conversations with the likes of Dr. Tanvi Madan, Brigadier Firoz Hassan Khan and others. So stay tuned to